to Dublin, first of all, and welcome to the University Philosophical Society. Thank you so much for accepting our gold medal of honorary patronage. I know you wanted to say a few words just in response to the gold medal, so.
Well, of course, it's a huge honor to receive this gold medal. And I would love, you know, to have a word of wisdom for you, but if I was a very wise person, I would not be this excited to get a gold medal. So, you know, but I'm really excited, and I know about your college, I know about your society, even before being invited here, so, yeah.
Perfect. So we might move into a question and answer session. And so I'm going to start off and ask a few questions, and then we're going to open it up to the floor. So if everyone wants to have a think about now in the next few minutes of any questions you might want to ask, and but I'll just begin. So just, what was the biggest, yeah?
No, wait, no, go ahead.
So what was the biggest challenge for you in bringing your graphic novel Persepolis to the big screen? And did it make it more difficult that it was your own life story that you're trying to bring alive?
That's a long question.
Yeah.
First of all, before everything, I have to beg you to excuse me for my English, because is absolutely not a language that I have learned. I learned how to speak English by watching American films. So needless to say that at the beginning when I started speaking English, I used the word fuck, you know, like every second word. And then the first people that spoke English, that was the Irish people in the pub down off my house in Paris that used the same word. So if I will swear and not be very polite, it's your fault. It's just to suffer. The idea of making a movie out of this book, it was absolutely not my idea, because even today, if you ask me honestly why I put it into a film, I would not have really any real answer to give you. You know, I can fantasize and make it look very nice, but in reality, the question was that why would I make something, you know, like for 4 years in a format, and then do the same thing again with another language in another format? And there is actually no answer to that. There was no need, really. But at the same time, these are these people that are producer, and they told me, okay, let's do that. And, you know, it's like if you give a, I don't know, big toy to a child, and the child will say, no, I won't play with it. So, you know, obviously I wanted to try something new. And by learning that, by learning to make movies, I was even paid, you know, which was, you know, a lot, you know. So I was really, my concern was like, I would make the shittiest movie in the world, because, you know, like adaptation of the book, normally they are not good. If the director is also the writer of the book, is even worse. So I had this idea that now I'm going to make the worst movie of the world, and it was really like diving into the water and then saying, oh, I don't know how to swim, and figure out how to swim at the same time as I was diving into the water. So it was very, very difficult. But the biggest difficulty was that before making a film, I always worked all alone, just by myself, you know, and I didn't have this producer with this concern about money, and this one who has an idea, and the other one who has another idea, because everybody wants to be so creative, what they say, which doesn't mean anything. Creative, that means we have to make it for cheaper. When they tell you creative, that is basically what it means. And, you know, all these people involved, and also, you know, it is the story of my life, is my drawing, so you have this 100 people that not only, you know, they want to draw with like me, but, you know, they you know, whatever I say is like the word of God, you know, like I say something and everybody takes it so seriously. So first of all, I'm a smoker. So in the morning, I'm really in bad mood. So I come in and, you know, that is all these people, tell you, you know, hi. And I'm like, and then, you know, you have to be very, you know, you are like a teacher and you have to explain to them everything. But really, for the first year, I hated them so much, all these people. Like every morning I was like, God, give cancer to all of them, kill them all. So I don't have to see their faces anymore. You know, because of all this, you have to be nice and you know, and then I can be nice for a couple of hours, but you know, then I need to be by myself. And then I realized that actually when you make films, you know, these people, they're not just there to bother you. They're also there, you know, to bring their talent over what you know how to do, and then all of that will make a film. So it was a very challenging thing for many, many reasons. Yeah, but it was difficult, yeah.
Yes, so my next question, it's a bit of a long one, but So, go ahead. A theme we see throughout Persepolis is a tension between your Iranian heritage and the classically Western culture which you've embraced when in Vienna. So partying, drinking, having a boyfriend without being married, a tension which is later intensified when you return to Iran by the oppressive Islamic regime. So do you see a dichotomy between Iranian and Western cultural values, or is there a space for an Iranian identity that is progressive or secular, yet distinctly Iranian?
Wow. Okay. First of all, I had to say, for me, it was not a cultural shock. You know, I went to a French school from the age of four. I came from a family that was atheist. We were not a very conventional family. It was not a problem for my family that I would have a boyfriend outside of marriage. I mean, the biggest cultural shock that actually I have had in my life was with the Japanese. And still, they're from the same continent. We are east and west of Asia, you know. It's like anywhere I have gone in my life, like even Zululand, you know, like in the mountains of South Africa. You know, the first day you are like, oh, these people, they are so different from me. And then the second day, oh, a little bit less. And after 1 week, you're like, oh, okay, these are exactly, it's no problem. With the Japanese, it was just the contrary. Sorry if there is any Japanese here. But really, the first day I was like, they're a human being like me. And day number 10, I was like, they come from another planet. I just could not get what was going on. You know, I just couldn't do it. But with West, it was not that. It was more my problem was that, you know, I left Iran at the moment it was war. And when you leave your family and your friends and it's bombing every day over there and it's not easy, then it is more the bad conscience as that you have that you're doing that. And then that is the point of view of the Westerners over you, because they think, they thought, and they still keep on thinking that, you know, like the Iranian wake up and, you know, from the morning, you know, they're just praying for God and beating them themselves and, you know, and how am I going to destroy the West? And which is absolutely not true, you know. I mean, the country Iran, I mean, and this is the studies, it's not me inventing it, is the most pro-Western country in this whole region. So, you know, that is no animosity against the West, you know, and it is like, you know, like sometimes, even today, you know, they call me from the people that they still make disc, you know, for singers. And they're like, oh, so we have this music, you know, Sufi music from South Sudan. And, you know, I fucking don't listen to the Sufi music. I don't like it, you know. I even don't like the Iranian traditional music. But this is this idea that you come from the Orient and, you know, oh, you know, and, you know, like the whole day you're in another mood, which is not true. And I mean, I grew up listening to the same music that you're listening to, most probably also because my parents, they were very Westernized. I don't think that is the whole Iran, but anyway. But we all grow up in the same way. My biggest difficulty was to make people understand that, because, you know, the society, I mean, the whole world functioning like that. The first thing is that the less you know about something and the more convinced you are about this thing, the more ignorant you are and the more sure you are about this is like this, because ignorance has this virtue to make you think that you are extremely intelligent. The problem is that the more you know, then the more you understand that it's complex, and then you know that you don't know so much. So the ignorance of people was the first thing. And, you know, so this is, it was this whole explanation that no, my father is not Ayatollah Khomeini, and no, my father does not have seven wives, and no, we are not living under a tent. I mean, they ask me questions, you can even not imagine it. So the problem, it was not me with the Westerners, it was the other way around, because I traveled to Europe lots of time before the Iranian Revolution. So I knew what was West, but they didn't know. And, you know, the press and, you know, the TV and the radio and all the journalists, they play a big role, because, you know, we were the country of the 1001 night with a king and a queen and the flying carpet and gold and diamond. And then suddenly our flying carpet became flying rockets. And, you know, with the king and queen, they became the guardian of the revolution. And it just stopped. I mean, people, they just forgot that it was a country with 4,000 of history before. The story of Iran started at 1979, like if the country never existed before. So that was all of that was so difficult. But then, of course, you know, when you go in any other country, you know, the culture is different. But, you know, I hate this word of the shock of the culture. This thing does not exist. It's crap. It's just a nonsense. The culture is not something that just happens that it stops at the frontier of a country. Like in West, we are saying, oh, it's the Westerner culture is very much based, is Judeo-Christian and is Greek. So now I will tell you something and you can just go and check out on internet if you don't believe me. But Christmas, that is the 24th of December, is the celebration of Mitra that comes from my country. So the pagan in Europe, they celebrated Mitra, and then what happened, Christianity came, and Jesus was born somewhere there, you know, in the winter time. And so they made Christmas, but it was a continuation of the celebration of Mitra. The pagan, they take that. And I can give you examples like that forever. Or, you know, you can see, for example, a poet like Khayyam, you know, very prominent, important Iranian poet. He's completely forgotten in Iran. So that is this guy Fitzgerald, the British one, not the American one, who take the poem of Khayyam and who translate them. And then Khayyam becomes something in England, so it becomes again something in Iran. You understand? And this poem of Khayyam, mostly they become a kind of a inspiration for a poet like Baudelaire and, you know, French poets. And the French poets, they become an inspiration for the modern poet of Iran. So you see, I mean, thinking that, you know, you have a culture and it stops there is just stupid. It doesn't exist. You know, culture is like the ring of a chain, and all the cultures, in a way or another, they're united. Just you take the fairy tales. I have fairy tales. I'm sure they're Iranian. I go to the Corsican island, the Corsican, they say these are Corsican fairy tales. You go to Greece, they're sure that they're... It's the same fairy tales. Everywhere is the same. You have the same story, the main character changed the name, so one has to pass seven deserts and the other one is passing seven seas, because depending on the geography. But the basis of the story is the same. So, you know, if we stop thinking that it's not such a thing as culture or shock, then we might think that is a future for the human being. I think that is the world is absolutely not divided between East and West and North and South and Christian and the Muslim. And it's not that, you know. I mean, you know, the colons that went to America to make to create America, the European that went there, the beginners, they were like Taliban. They are so religious, you know. I mean, everybody forgets about this the history. The thing is that the world is, it is a division in the world, and the division in the world, it is between the fanatics and the normal people. And these fanatic, crazy people, they're the same amount everywhere. I have made a very scientific calculation. The number is between 12 and 18%, let's say 15%. You have 15% of very dumb people everywhere. But the thing is that these people, they have, you hear them. And do you know why you hear them? It's because they're ignorant. And the fanaticism works with emotion. Press on the button of emotion, and you have people going out and yelling and wanting to give their life and na-na-na and dying and exploding and all of that. Obviously, if you think you will never do that, because it takes you a while before, you know, just spousing this emotion and just going and doing stuff. So if we understand that, then we might think that we can create a better world. But obviously that will never work, because we human beings are extremely stupid. So that will never work. It was just a hope. I mean, I don't talk about you, because, you know, you're in the Trinity College and you're all very bright, but I'm talking, you know, generally, it doesn't work this way.
And then just touching on that, so in your book, Embroideries, which offers a frank account of a conversation among your female family members about men, love, and sex, you kind of challenge a lot of assumptions that people would place on Iranian people as being maybe sexually oppressive. So how important is it through your work?
But Iranian people, they are sexually oppressive. I mean, that is something that is called the tradition. I mean, now it is changing. But, you know, this fact that, you know, a girl has to be a virgin before marriage, et cetera, it is part of the culture. It has been everywhere, and then everywhere has evolved, you know. But if we think that it's a very male-dominant place, it's not true, neither, because the Iranian women, they are extremely strong, and we have a history of very strong women and queens and these things in the past history that makes that Yeah, just it was just, you know, this moment that I heard this conversation, because, you know, I watched actually, the idea came one night. I was watching this thing on this very cultural TV channel that is called Arte. So they are very, you know, picky, and it's very intellectual, and it's very nice, and na-na-na. So the name of the program is the Divorce al Iranian, so the divorce the Iranian way. Okay. And so I hear people talking in Persian, and obviously is the subtitle in French. And so that is this woman who is arguing with her husband, and she say, "You shut the fuck up, otherwise, you know, tonight I'm going to make you digest your teeth." Which means I'm going to, you know, punch you in your face, I'm going to break your teeth, you're going to swallow these teeth, and you have to digest them. Under the subtitle is like, "Please stop speaking." And I'm like, I mean, this is not what she said. So, but it doesn't arrange us to write that, because suddenly it becomes more difficult to understand. If you make this little place, then it is, okay, that is what we think, and that is what we get. We don't like complicated stuff. So, you know, all the works that I did, you know, it was in a way, it was a response, you know, to because I kept on saying these things, but, you know, at one point you get bored to say the same things over and over. You know, you just, I think it's Primo Levi, I think, or I don't know, or another Italian writer that he say, writing is the only way to express yourself without being interrupted. So it's not that I don't like to speak. As you see, I can speak. But, you know, this repetition over and over, it was really a need, you know, to do it, yeah.
Yeah, so that's me for my question. So we're going to maybe open it up to the audience. So if anyone has a question, like to
don't be shy.
Raise your hand.
Yeah.
Over here.
Half Irish and half what? Okay. I know what it is. Well, of course, you know, human being, the difference between, thank you for the question. You might sit down because my answer is going to be long, so, you know, you might get tired. The reason, you know, like the shrimp in the ocean, they don't make any war, and the human beings, they make war, is that it's something that is called the memory, is that you, from one generation to the other generation, not only you transmit your trauma, but also your hate. So after 10 generations, you hate people, and you still don't know why you hate them, but you have to hate them, because we just, you know, say it over and over. I mean, you know, like Iranians, they hate Arabs. They hate them, because, you know, they came, they invade us, they stay for 500 years. So, you know, any Iranian, the first reaction is like, come on, which is stupid, because, you know, I mean, obviously all the Arabs, they are not bad, and all the Iranians, they are not good either. But, you know, like, in my generation, the effect that it had is like, you know, I know about, I don't know, let's say about 20 people, because after the Cuban immigration, a massive Cuban immigration of adolescents after Fidel Castro took the power, the second biggest massive immigration of adolescents was from Iran, because I was from the middle class, so it was not like my parents, they could leave, and, you know, we could just live on the money that existed. We, you know, my parents, they had to work, so I could just continue studying. So we really left, you know, at the age of 14 without our parents. The result of that is that I know about, let's say, 20 people still that live the same thing as I lived. From these 20 people, 18 of us, we have never made kids, you know, and I'm 45. So it has this thing because, you know, to make, for example, a child, you need to be able to project yourself in the future. But to be able to project yourself in the future, you have to rely on your past. But if your past is stolen from you, and if you don't have any belief in the human being, how do you do it? So with us, the generation of our parents, since, you know, the monkeys existed, is going to end, which is completely okay. You know, I don't say it as a sad thing. I'm very happy to have made this choice, but I see the results on us, you know. So of course you have to go through that, but this is nothing that we can do. You know, like in the Balkan, as you know, the war came because it was, you know, it was at the time of the Ottoman, and you know, all the Bosnian, they were Muslim, and they were helping the Ottoman, they were with the Ottoman. So this hate after 200 years, it stays. Well, in the Western world, they made two world war. They really killed each other good, so now they can be in peace. In other places, we didn't make this war. So, you know, unfortunately, the memory of the history for the human being is about 10 days ago. I mean, if you look at the history is a repetition. It's a cycle of 50 years that comes over and over all the time. You know, like when George Bush attacked Iraq, the thing was that if we don't attack them, they will come and they will attack us. Okay. But, you know, 2,000 years ago, Julius Caesar said exactly the same thing. He said, if we don't go and we attack these Gaulois, you know, the French people, I mean, they were just, you know, pagan, they didn't have a big army. They're going to come and they're going to kill us. As a result, they came in France and they killed everyone and they took it over. Obviously, the French, they would not go and kill them because they did that. That was not such a thing. And obviously, the Iraqi, they wouldn't go and attack American either. But it's the same argument, and in a way, it comes over and over and over and over. But right now, what we are living is a time of religion and conservatism, which is the worst thing that can, in the history of human being, when the religion and the conservatism take over, I mean, both of them, they come together, actually. So we are living the worst moments, but maybe we are going to have a spring of love. It's going to be 1967 again, and it will change. But we have to wait a couple of years still. We have long bad days in front of us, so yeah.
And does anyone else have a question?
Yes. Well, frankly, I think that when you make a work of art, you should not be pretentious, and you should not think that, you know, the world will become a better place because you have made a good film. It doesn't work this way. I mean, if that worked, with all this song about I love you and all of that, you know, the world should be a place of love. You know, people, they listen to this music and they still go and kill each other. So, you know, the effect of that is a march of the history. That will be the march of the history, you know, and we can participate into that. And but it is not so much that, you know, I can change. Then, you know, really, frankly, you know, I mean, my books, I didn't write it for the Iranian. They know all of that, you know. I mean, all the explanation that I give that what is what and who said that, the Iranian, they know it. It was really the book that I wrote for the others. So the effect in the Iranian society, yeah, for the kids that are born after the revolution, maybe they discover things that their parents, they don't want to talk about, but that was not for them. But yeah, obviously, you know, the book and the film became very famous because it's on the black market, you know, and as soon as something is on the black market, it becomes much more exciting. That is why I don't understand, you know, where politicians, they always want to make law, you know, to forbid things. You know, as soon as you forbid something, it becomes much worse. You know, even if you take the religious story, you know, Adam and Eve, they say, okay, you do whatever you want, you have the whole paradise, whatever, and just don't eat the apple. What do they do first? They eat the apple. This is the nature of the human being. So in a way, I was really proud because, you know, at the time, you know, I was on the black market and I was buying, I don't know, Rolling Stone and, you know, Iron Maiden, and suddenly I was part of those. So I was like, wow, I'm cool. But, and what I hear is from my parents and my friends, so nobody will tell me they hate you because, you know, the people that talk to my parents and my friends, they know that, you know, they like me, so nobody say bad things. The Iranian regime was not very happy, but that's okay. So, I think it was good, but if it changed something, I don't think so at all. And I think in the Western world, I mean, you know, I have to keep the thing at the level. I don't think that it didn't change anything either. I mean, if it was not for the foreign policy and if they didn't fuck up in Afghanistan and Iraq, they would have bombed Iran by now. The only reason they didn't do it, it was not a success somewhere else. So I don't think that with my book I could stop the bombs. Otherwise, I would just keep on writing books, you know, like one per day. You know, I would work 26 hours per day to stop it. But unfortunately, the intellect and the brain takes much more time and is not the button of emotion. So it's less efficient, but there is no other way around. You know, we cannot play the same game.
Any more questions?
Yes. Well, I will tell you something. You know, we people, we want to change the society. We want to change our destiny. We want to change the course of the history, but we don't want to change ourselves. This is the first thing. And you know, that sounds like a very wise person who say that. But the reality of the fact is that, is, you know, I came very, very close to politics, and for a long, long time, you know. I worked for the Federation of the Human Rights for a long, long time. What did I discover is that 98% of people that work in this kind of organization is that they cannot get a better job, or they have so much problem in their life, so they can want to find people with even more problem than them, like that they can feel happy about it. It's like, oh, these people even more miserable. Yeah. You know, people that are with a conviction, they're very, very little. And therefore, you know, I stopped working for that because it is so much cynicism, because you see that it is like, oh, you know, I work for the human rights, and everybody is like, oh, what a nice person. It's more about that. And I really thought when I became 30, I was convinced that I could change the world. And after trying hard, I realized that the world was changing me. And the little good thing that was about me that I liked about myself was this hope in the human being and the, you know, the stars in my eyes, and, you know, believing that the human being is from a good nature, disappeared completely. I became extremely cynical and extremely sad. So at the end, did I change anything? I was even the ambassador for the European Union. So, you know, it was something. What did we do? We just go every week, and we are like, nya, 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 nya. And then it's like, okay, we make the decision next week, and the next week we go, and nya, 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 and then again and again for a year you go, and that is no decision taken. And once you take the decision, they tell you, yes, but, you know, we have some kind of business deal with this country, so we cannot really do it. So fuck that, man, you know. I go, okay, so then what am I doing? So what I think the first thing that we can do is to change ourselves. And it is really not, you know, to sound nice that I say that, but, you know, the first thing that we have to know is to have empathy and compassion. And I am going to tell you something, because it sounds like a philosophical idea or a humanistic idea, but it goes much more beyond that. It is actually biological. You know, the human being is not very well made as an animal. You know, we are not smooth like a cat, we cannot jump, we cannot, you know, all alone in the nature we are dead. You know, it's like, there is no way. We are absolutely not made, you know, to survive. You know, we are in these two legs, we have back problem, you know, we cannot climb, there is nothing we can do. Why human being took over? Because they made societies. because they had a brain. So now, in the human being, in the brain of the human being, believe me, what I'm telling you is scientific. It doesn't look like it, but it's true. We have something that called the mirror neurons. That means, for example, Matthew, he loves, you know, a food, and I tell him, oh, this is disgusting. And he will like it a little bit less, because his neuron, they make a mirror effect with mine, and that makes it that he likes it less. This is the base of our empathy. The empathy and the compassion is how we built the society. If we lose this empathy and if we lose this compassion, that is the end of the society. And if that is the end of the society, that is the end of the human race. So if we want to survive, we have to be nicer. And that has nothing to do with religion and this thing, because I'm an atheist, so I'm not giving you a moral lesson. It's just a question of survival. So if we just can put ourselves in the place of the others, it's not very complicated. Huh? You know, it came, like in France now, they have all this law against the women that have veil, and, you know, they go to the sea, oh my God, and they all the time ask me, what do you think? Well, what do I think is that I hate veil. You know, I cut my veil before coming to Europe. I cut them in two pieces, how much I hated it. I was like, never, ever again something will cover my head. I will always have the wind blowing in my hair, all of that, okay. But to be free, you know, when we say that we are free thinkers, that means being free, that means you have even to go beyond your own conviction. This is being free. And our freedom does not start when the other freedom, stop where the other freedom of the other people starts. No. All the freedom, they start together and they stop together. So yes, I don't like veil women, but I like them to be free to do what they want. So that is going, I put myself in her head. So I'm brought up in this family and I'm sure that if I don't cover this hair, I'm going to go to hell, and, you know, God is going to roast me like a roasted chicken, and, you know, all the bad things will happen and all of that. Maybe she's right. Maybe I will end up roasted like a roasted chicken. Who knows? But, you know, who am I to say to people to do or not to do? So, you know, this is the tolerance, the empathy, the compassion, and trying. We cannot change the society if we don't change ourselves. We cannot all say we want another world, but we want ourselves to be ourselves. It doesn't work. We have to start with ourselves. And once we do that, I think it's the only efficient way, because I really don't believe in politics. Huh? You know, I read an article about the biggest psychopath in the world, you know, according to the job they have. And the first group, guess what? They're politicians, obviously. I mean, who wants to be responsible for millions of people? I have problem taking care of my own hair. I mean, how do I get, can I take care of, I don't know, 10 million people? Why would I want to do that? So they're a psychopath, and the power should not be given to the people that wants the power, but then you cannot give it to the people who doesn't want the power. So, you know, we are in trouble. So I don't think that anything can be changed by politics because of their psychological portrait. They're psychopaths. I'm convinced about that. And if they are not, they end up, you know, a mayor of a small city somewhere. You know, to become a minister and all of that, you have to have some. Yeah. You know what I mean.
And do you have any other questions?
Yes. The yes. It's untreated. Yeah. Well, the problem, I think, you know, the Muslim community in France, you know, these are the people, you know, first of all, we have to go back to the history. I mean, France had lots of colonies. These people, you know, basically they come from this colony. So that is always a relationship between the one who created the colony and the colony themselves. So then these people, they came in the 50s, in the 60s, and after 3-4 generations, they're still not considered as French. You know, they're always, you know, like if you're Romanian or Italian, after one generation you become French, but when you are from this side, they always call them les Français issus de l'immigration. the French coming from the immigration, just to note down that they come from North Africa. This is basically where they come from. So there are 5-6 million, but they are treated as if they are renting the place. You know, when you rent a place, when that is a problem with the heater or something, that is the owner that has to pay. If you want the people to take care of the heater, they have to consider themselves as owner, then they pay for it. But these people, they are considered as if they are renting. They are not there for, you know, they have paid the price, but the house is not theirs. And if we want them to be part of the society, we have to give them this paper of ownership. You are also owner of the society. So, you know, the problem is vast. And then on the other side, the people, you know, they of course take advantage of that. I mean, it has happened to me, you know, that was this little Arab kid, and, you know, he wanted me to give him a cigarette, and then I gave him a cigarette, and then he wanted the second one, and I said, listen, it's two left, and it's for me and my friend, so, you know, I'm not going to give you a second one. And he spit in my face, and I slapped him in his face, and he said, you do that because I'm an Arab. I said, no fucking way, I do that because you're stupid. I mean, you could be blonde, you know. You spit in my face, I spit in your face. It has nothing to do. So they think that also everything that you do is because of that. So it's a very complex thing. But if the government, they, you know, until we have things in France, like we are going to talk about all the good that colonialism made to these people, we don't solve the problem. At one point, we have to say, listen, what we did was wrong. You are French, and, you know, try to construct. But it's a very long cultural work, and nobody wants a long cultural work. You know, we want to be election in 6 months, and, you know, let's give, you know, these words that are shocking and all of that. So if there is no long-term work, it's not going to work. And at the same time, you know, I'm not a specialist of that. You know, I come from a very bourgeois family. You know, my country has never been a colony, and I even don't know the Parisian suburb, because, you know, I'm kind of a wimp and I don't go to the suburb because I'm sure that they're going to kill me, which of course is not true. But, you know, never go. So, but looking from outside, and even my friends that are, you know, that are open-minded and they're from the left, and every time they have a friend whose name is Mohammed or something, I say, oh, I have this friend, you know, my Arab friend. But the guy, you know, I mean, his father was born in France, and he's born in France, so, you know, I mean, at one point you have to, they're just French. So, yeah.
Yeah, do you have any other questions? Yeah.
Yes, absolutely. Well, you know, what happened in Iran, actually, I even heard something that I did, I was not aware of it. It was this Ayatollah Muntazeri, I don't know if you know about him, that everybody called him the meow, the cat, because, you know, he was all the time, and he was nagging like a cat. Anyway, when the revolution happened, anyway, let's not go back this far, because then it's become very complicated. So, the Iranian revolution obviously was made by leftists, you know, like my parents, they didn't want to install an Islamic Republic, you know, they wanted to have a society of justice. We had a lots of poor people in a country that was just 35 million people, but we had a lots of poor people, the lots of people that didn't have access to school, to university, to anything. So all of that was made in the idea that we are going to have a good society. And everybody has to listen also to what Ayatollah Khomeini said at the time, you know. I mean, people that were behind him, and everybody, he was saying, yeah, I'm just a mullah, we will make this revolution, and I will go back to my mosque, and I believe in democracy. So everybody bought it, you know. And we were also in the country, you know, with, a huge portion of illiterated people. 70-80% of people, they could not read and write. So, you know, the idea of democracy and na-na-na, is not something that gather people when they even don't know how to read and write. How do you gather them? The idea of nationalism and religion, and you put them together, and so. And then they took the power, and then they, of course, you know, like always, a revolution is always made by, you know, idealists, and is recuperated by the cynical one. And they had the biggest chance is that Saddam attacked the country. So from the moment that you have a war that is from the exterior, anybody is from the interior that you consider as enemy, you can kill them. And even Khomeini say, he said, baroy modar dar jang ast, that means we can stay because of this war. Our stay depends on this war. So in the name of the exterior enemy, they actually stopped whoever was the people that were actually fighting with the Shah and saw this republic. They stopped all of them, and they killed many, 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 many of them. And it was my uncle, but, you know, we also had lots of friends because, you know, my family, they were lefties. So that was lots of people that were not killed by the Shah and were killed by this regime. So, yeah, this is, but the war, if that was no war, they could not do it. But it was the war, and so, you know, let's kill everyone because we don't have the, in the name of the war, anybody is called an enemy and everybody is deserved to die. And that is what happened, so, yeah.
And do you have any other questions?
Yeah. Well, my biggest inspiration as a writer has always been Dostoevsky. I think he's the biggest of all. He's the only one that when I read, he and Flaubert, I like him a lot. I really have the feeling that I understand a little bit more about the human nature, you know. I think it's, and both of them, they have lots of humor. Dostoevsky is actually extremely funny. I mean, if you really read it, you know, his consideration of the situation. He has always been a source of inspiration, and that is why also I didn't become a full writer, because, you know, you read him and you're like, you know, I will never write this good, even by killing myself, even by living 500 years, he will always do it better. But, okay, I will make some cartoons and, you know, it will... At least there is a space there where I can be brilliant because, yeah, so that's him. Then the idea that I had about comic books is that the idea that everybody else had, you know, I mean, for people, comic books, and now it's called graphic novel because, you know, which is, it almost sounds like a porn book, you know, graphic novels, novel with graphics. But, you know, it was at one point, you know, they said the editors, the publisher, they said to themselves, people, they don't like to say we read comics because comics has been always the reading for kids or adolescent or retarded adults. Basically, that is what it was, you know. I mean, it always had these guys, you know, like that, you know, with the long hair like that and, you know, full of sweat, you know, coming with the comic book. I met lots of them. And So that was the idea that I had, and then they gave me the book Mouse of R. Spiegelman, and I realized that it was just a medium. You know, it was just a way to express yourself, and I really like to draw, and I really like to write, and the combination of these two was comics. So these were the things that inspired me back then. I tried to read all the classics. I'm not very much into the modern literature because I read lots of them and I was really, really disappointed. So I said to myself, I will try to read, you know, all the Lord Byron and all the Oscar Wilde and all the Dostoevsky and Tolstoy. And even for that, you know, I need a long, long life. And once I have read that, it's not that people, they are more dumb now, but I think it's that the thing is going faster, so there is no time for real reflection sometimes. And, like, and you know, these are also writers, you know, like I love John Irving, and as he started becoming older and he wanted to fuck more and more with girls of 20, and, you know, he's 75, but everything functioned well, and it kind of put me, you know, I'm like, not you, come on, you know, you were better than that, and... So I kind of give up. So I try to read the classic, but now my passion is cinema. So I go very much to the cinema, very, very much so. So yeah, and you have a large amount of film that you can see and that are really good. Yeah. Yes? Dipan, yes. Yes. I've seen all the film in the world. No, it's not true, but I've seen a lot of them. Well, you know, I love the European cinema. The system of the European cinema is very good because, you know, we have the final cut, everything. But, you know, in America, you have really independent American movies, you know, that become more and more difficult to make them. But there are a real scene of independent movies that are very, very interesting. You know, I would not just reject all the American cinema. You have all this blockbuster and all of that, but some of them, they're really cool. Like, you know, I love Deadpool, you know, or the first Spider-Man, I really like it. I know, you know, I forget about them, but they are not bad films. The French cinema, yeah, you have lots of good things, like Dipan is a very good film, but I think that they're a little rough with the British, because for me, the best person who make a social film is Ken Loach. I mean, nobody does it the way he does, because everybody else in France or in Belgium, you know, is always this bourgeois that look, you know, at poor people like, oh, poverty is the worst thing that can happen to you. So is the point of view is this Catholic leftist condescending bourgeois people that, you know. And if people, they are poor, obviously their kids, they have AIDS or they're retard. Obviously they have all the other problems. You know, it's not enough to be poor. You have to have all of it. And Ken Loach is the only one that actually, you know, take a character like in My Name is Joe or Looking for Eric or, you know, the Angel Share. And he makes out of these people that are supposed to be nobody really real people, you know, you're proud to have known them. So I think you have a good British cinema too. Yeah. Yes.
Thank you again for coming here. It's been wonderful having you here. I shouldn't ask what the...
You are very good that you're there, because you laugh at whatever I say. So I feel very comforted. I feel every time I look at you, I'm sure that I'm very funny. Thank you very much. Go ahead. Yes, you know, film is a very complicated thing to do, because not only, you know, you have to work with a team, but you have the technology that evaluates. You have, you know, the way of telling films that evaluate. You have the rhythm that evaluates. Everything evaluates. So it's a very exciting thing. And also cinema is really a machine of compassion, of creating compassion. Imagine America without Hollywood. Do you really think that they could sell us this idea of the American dream if that was no Hollywood? I mean, you know, America, you know, I have spent lots of time there. It looks like a very huge, rich communist country. Everybody is dressed the same way. You know, everybody has the same shape. Everybody, you know, think the same thing. It's very bad not to be part of a religion. You know, it. And, you know, all these houses that are made of paper and all of that, and they show that us, and everybody said, that is the way we want to live. They were able to do that because they showed us Clark Gable and they showed us this and that, and we were like, oh, this is America. So the power of cinema is a huge, huge power, you know. That is why in any dictatorship they make movie of propaganda. It is the thing that works the best. So I love that. So I'm preparing a film, but I don't have the right to say it, and that is not to play the mysterious woman. I really cannot say it. I promise I will not talk about it. Otherwise, I'm writing a book, a real book. It will never be Dostoevsky, but, you know, I'm at the age that I cannot suffer from that anymore, because otherwise I will not do anything anymore in my life. And I also paint, you know, I make my... You know, but I hope that, you know, later in my life it will be something else that I will do. You know, because I think if I could have like two or three other lives, that would be really good. So who knows what I will do later? Maybe I will become a dancer or anything. Yeah, for sure. But you know, if you have a plan of career and this thing is not a very good thing, because then you have to stuck to something and then you do the same thing over and over. Yeah, I really don't know. Right now it's cinema and my painting and I like to do stuff. But I'm also very okay doing nothing, to tell you the truth. You know, I can just be there and think about nothing. So that I like it very much too. So maybe at one point I will just stop. Who knows?
I think I have one more question before you.
No, two more. I mean, there is another. We have time. I'm here to talk to them. Please. No, I understand your question, especially since it was an animation. People, the relationship that they have with me is like the same relationship they have with Mickey Mouse or Donald Duck, or, you know, they're like, wow, here is the mouse. No, but this obviously, 25 years of my life or 20 years of my life could not hold in 400 pages of comic books. That would mean that my life was extremely poor and miserable and I didn't leave anything. Obviously, I have to choose moments of my life. But of course, you create, you know, this intimacy. Of course, it's not a documentary. You know, you're writing a story, so, you know, you have to imagine, you know, the dialogues, you know, you have also to imagine, you know, you have to cheat, and this is the way you make the thing. Yeah, I have a very bizarre... Normally people, they are very nice, but it was these two times that happened to me that was very bizarre. One time that was this woman who came to me and she started to say all the books of me that she loved, and she seated like, I don't know, six books, and I wrote none of them, like not even one. And so this was one time that it was, and another time it was, I was going to buy myself an underwear in a supermarket. So while I'm looking at that, between the underwears is the face of a man who comes out like that. And he says, I love the story of your childhood. And I told him, and I was like, sir, can we just meet outside? Because now he's, and he was like, okay. And then the face disappeared again. So that was really this tumor. But usually people, they're extremely cool and they're not intrusive to me. I receive sometimes letters of people fantasizing about, you know, a life that I have that I don't have. But yeah, I mean, you know, I expose myself. So, you know, from the moment that you expose yourself, you cannot say, oh, why people, you know, I did it. So, yeah, this is the price to pay, then you pay. Yes. Well, you know, the story of the key and the martyrhood, it is, doesn't only belong to Iran. I mean, when they say to these people from, you know, South America, in America, go and fight in Iraq and we give you the citizenship or a green card, is the same thing, is the key to the paradise. Yeah, these kids, you know, that come from poor neighborhoods, they don't have nothing. And, you know, they tell them, you know, if you go and you go on a mine thing and you explode, you will go to paradise. And these kids, they believe and they do it because, I mean, their life down in this earth is so bad that, you know, how can it be worse? So we go and, you know, we will have the 7 2 2 2 virgins and, you know, this and that. And, you know, I even read something of the people of Daesh, that is this guy who got exploded and he put like a belt, very good, you know, on his penis. So like, his dick will not explode because he's promised that he's going to sleep with all this woman. So even if the rest is not there, the penis is still there. It can just function, you know, I mean, it goes this far. It comes from the sexual frustration of people. It comes from the poverty. It comes, you know, you can always use poverty for everything. When people, they have nothing to lose, they just go for it, you know. And that is where I want to say also, you know, I mean, the role of culture is important, but, you know, before I was like, the last thing that I believe in is culture. Frankly, if you look at Germany in 1930, the number of intellectual and very, very well-educated people is not little. You know, Goebbels, he's a doctor in philosophy. Mengele, he's a surgeon. You know, these people, they have knowledge. I mean, doctor in philosophy. And why is it that they become Nazi, for example? Because they're humiliated from the First World War, because you have to bring this bag of Deutschmark to be able to buy a piece of bread, because of poverty and humiliation. That is the way it goes bad. So what can we deduce from that? Is that if you want the world to be a better place, before the culture and everything, we have to have a minimum of decent life for everyone. You know, people, when they have empty bellies, they don't think about, am I free? What is my rights? The guy is hungry, and he has to feed himself, and he has to feed his kids. You know, this is the kind of question you even don't have the time to ask yourself. So we need to have a minimum of life for everyone. And when I say that, I look like a hardcore communist, because I say that, you know, our world is not functioning. 50 years ago in America, the salary of a CEO comparing to a normal worker, it was the salary of the worker multiplied by 40, which is a lot. Today is 500 times. I mean, no matter how excellent you are, 500 times more than of the other one. Why? You know, so we have to do that, but, you know, we do that if, again, we change ourselves. If the day that you are a CEO and you don't accept to be paid 500 times the other ones, then maybe you have done something. And it is not really to send myself flowers or to say that I'm a very nice lady, because I'm not, but, you know, like on Persepolis, I say that everybody had to have the same salary, including myself. I did it. And therefore, we could finish the movie in 15 months because everybody worked with their heart and everybody worked extremely much because, you know, it was not this. We have solutions, but, you know, all this thing, you know, of poverty is the basic of everything bad that is in this world. Unfortunately, all the religion, they love poverty. Because, of course, you know, if people, they don't have anything, then they buy so easily the idea of paradise, you know. Just die, you know, here, you know, no problem, we will go to the paradise. This thing doesn't happen. And why do we believe in this thing? Because the human being is arrogant. For us, it's impossible to believe that. The reason that we die is the same reason as the worm dies. This is it. You know, at one point, the cell, they stop reproducing themselves, so the next generation would be better. Taller, you know, like with bigger teeth, I don't know what. And this is the reason of your death, of mine, of the cat, of the worm, and of a bacteria. All of us with that, but the human being with the brain is like, it's not possible, you know. Of course, you know, it must be a life after that. Don't be this arrogant. We are just like the worm. We die, big deal. You know, we have to. It's not like we can stop doing it, you know. It will happen no matter. Please. Well, I feel extremely cool that my books are read in the university. No, because, you know, like, I don't know, like, how many years ago was it? Like 15 years ago, you know, when my book first, 16 years ago, when my book got published first, you know, the difference of age between you and me was not a lot. Today I can be your mom if I want to, you know, so you know. And I'm very happy that, you know, still... I'm on the young side, you know, because I still can connect. You know, the worst thing in life is to become an old fart, you know. It's like, you know, you're like, nya, you become sour and all of that. It makes me extremely happy. And then when I see all of you, it also gives me, frankly, it gives me lots of hope, you know, because my generation, we were kids in the 80s. And in the 80s, everybody had this shoulder pad, and everybody wanted to go to the business school, and everybody wanted, you know, to be Mickey Rourke, and, you know, in 9.5 weeks, and roll, and, you know, and everybody wanted to make lots of money. And we were, like, the nerd of the school because we wanted to go to the art school, and everybody was like, you know. And now this is the situation. We were really, the shit generation was the 80s. We really didn't do anything good out of it. The new generation gives me a lot of hope. You know, I see all of you, and I'm very happy. I think that the world will become none of you will become a yuppie, so that's okay. So we can hope that the world is going to be a better place. Yes. Yes. It's not the sexism for the male-dominated. You know, the comics appeared at the same time of the cinema. And what was the comics? It was a small strip down of the, you know, newspaper. So the man of the house comes, read the newspaper, and then he read the comics. At the time, who is supposed, you know, so you are a woman, you're supposed, you know, to play a little bit of piano, bing, 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 you know, to know to how to sew, you know, to make your hair. This is what you're supposed to do. So this thing of having fun is a male thing. So the people that read comics, they were boys. So obviously, this is the boys that continue doing them. Like me, when I grew up, you know, the comics that it was, I mean, out of Wonder Woman, it was everything, all the hero, they were male. So it was really nobody that I could identify with. So it was not the comics that I would read, like you'd read Tintin or all the French comics, you know, that was nothing that I could identify with. Then also it's, I don't know, it's also, you know, women, they have to trust in themselves a little bit more, you know. I think it's, you know, I was in a studio with 8 guys, and I was the only girl, so it created a lots of, you know, sparkle in the air. And one day I was, that was in the month of August, I came. And all of them, they were in their underwears, you know, trying to shock me or I don't know what. And they were like, hee, 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 you know, like schoolgirls, they were laughing, like, hee, hee. So, you know, I went to my table and I worked. And so the day after, I came earlier and I put myself in my underwear. And they came and they say, you're in your underwears. I was like, yeah, it's very hot outside, you know, it's like, I'm warm, I have to take it out. And they are like, but we cannot work. I was like, yeah, I worked yesterday, all of you were naked, so today is my turn. Never ever they took out their clothes anymore. You know, it's, you know, I could be offense and say, oh, you know, but, you know, men, they're like nice children. It's easy to deal with them. For me, it's much more difficult to deal with women. Jesus Christ, you know, he's like, you know, you shout on a woman, she remembers 5 years after, you know. With a man, I'm always like, hey, come on. And okay, it's forgotten. So, you know, we are difficult people. I know myself, I never forget anything. So it's male dominated because of the history, but there are more and more girls that make comics and, you know, you just should do it. And it always will be a stupid person who will tell you something, but, you know, stupidity is really not a male character. It belongs to male and female, both of them, so.